President Marcos urges graduates of the Philippine Merchant Maritime Academy to help the country preserve its global reputation in the maritime industry. Marcos made the appeal during the graduation rites of the PMMA Class of 2023 in San Narciso, Zambales.
I encourage you to continue to do everything with the same amount of passion and resilience that you have shown during the time you had here in PMMA. Whatever challenges you may face, be open to how you can live up to your class name. Magigiting na may dangal at simbolo ng kawal ng karagatan. As you do so, help the Philippines maintain its name as a global figure in the maritime industry and an asset to the entire world.
The Philippine government has committed to improve the country's education, training, and certification for its seafarers to address serious issues earlier flagged by the European Union. The two-decade territorial dispute between Makati City and Taguig over the Fort Bonifacio Military Reservation finally ends. Taguig welcomes the categorical declaration of Makati Mayor Abby Binay that the city will respect the Supreme Court's ruling that Fort Bonifacio... Now, the Philippine Transportation Department hopes interested parties in the privatization of Manila's main gateway will begin submitting their proposals in the next 2 months. Transportation Secretary Jaime Bautista adds the agency will publish the terms of reference for the bidding next month.
Ang kaibahan naman dun sa ginawang unsolicited proposal, sila ang nagdidikta. Sinasabi nila, ito yung gusto naming gawin, ito yung gusto naming ibayad na upfront payment. Ang share nyo sa revenue ng airport ay ganito lang. Yung solicited proposal, we started working on this as early as December last year. I engaged the services of the Asian Development Bank to be our advisor, no? And tinulungan nila kami na i-define yung mga terms of reference.
Telco giant Globe launches its prepaid fiber service. Our correspondent Jackie Pascual is on the line to tell us more. Hi, Jackie.
Hi, good afternoon, Denise. Telecommunications firm Globe has formally launched G-Fiber Prepaid, which it sees as a big growth driver for the telco business. The company also eyes prepaid fiber to grow and outpace the postpaid internet service. At its media launch in Taguig, Globe President and CEO Ernest Cu said there was a huge market for prepaid service for fiber Wi-Fi, as many Filipinos need fast internet connection for business, learning, and entertainment. He said even the mobile SIM service, over 90% are prepaid subscribers and only a few are postpaid. And this will potentially be the same growth rate for the fiber Wi-Fi service. Who said inflation has affected many Filipinos, with some letting go of broadband connection. But with this new prepaid fiber service, this could help the public manage their expenses when it comes to connectivity, which is very essential nowadays. They are targeting low-income consumers as the prepaid fiber does not have a lock-in period, and subscribers can choose the plan they want. Denise, there's a 299 pesos for 7 days unlimited plan, for example, up to around 999 pesos for 30 days. Raymond Policarpio, the vice president of Globe at Home Brand Management, said that it's an easy application process. No documents, no lock-in, and price points are lower compared to the usual postpaid execution. And they hope to the public that the Class D and E market will benefit from this new service, as they hope to narrow down the so-called digital divide. Currently, there are about 26% households who have broadband connection, and they say the remaining 70+% that's a huge potential market for this prepaid fiber.
The Philippine Business Bank highlights the importance of local lenders in addressing the needs of small and medium businesses in the country. This, as PBB says, MSMEs, regarded as the backbone of the Philippine economy, have been bearing the brunt of high interest rates and that kind of environment for quite some time now. MSMEs also making up about 99% of all registered businesses in the country, employing at least 5.4 million Filipinos. They are also generating about 40% of the country's gross domestic product.
We have seen here that the rise in interest rates obviously hurts a lot of the businesses, especially the MSMEs, to which we are very much involved in. Over the next few months, I think it will be crucial for us to look at how the economy will continue to move, given the sensitivity of companies to high interest rates. Banking system has to be more adaptive by being able to respond to the needs of the MSMEs, because this is the sector to which the Philippine economy would be depending on for further growth moving forward.
The earnings season also getting underway here at home, starting with Bank of the Philippine Islands. BPI reported Thursday a 13 billion peso quarterly net income, higher by 4.5% year on year. Total revenues for Q2 climbed nearly 5% at 34 billion pesos. For the first half of the year, the local lender saw its net income jumping 23% to 25.1 billion pesos. Now, BPI attributes the strong showing to average asset base expansion, margin growth, and lower provisions. Looking at its share price this Thursday, it was up 1.2% at 114.80 pesos apiece. China's envoy to the U.S. warns of retaliation if Washington imposes more curbs on its chip sector. Ambassador Xi Feng says China does not want a trade or tech war, but it will definitely respond to U.S. curbs. He was referring to reports that Washington is considering an outbound investment review mechanism and further prohibition of the export of AI chips to China. A Biden administration official has said the executive order may be ready around Labor Day, or that's September 4th. This is the latest in the tit-for-tat restrictions between the world's two biggest economies amid a race for tech dominance. A slew of economic data across the Asia-Pacific region this Thursday, beginning in China, where its central bank held steady its 1.5-year loan prime rates unchanged. The numbers still at 3.55 and 4.2% respectively, coming days after Beijing also kept its medium-term facility loan rates unchanged. In Japan, a good kind of surprise in June. It recorded for the first time in almost 2 years a trade surplus of 43 billion yen, or over $308 billion. This was a reversal of the 1.38 trillion yen deficit in May. Looking at Tokyo's trade figures, we're seeing imports down 13% year-on-year in June, while exports were up 1.5%. And in Australia, the magic number is 3.5%. Its unemployment rate, which was unchanged, is lower than the forecast of 3.6. A check on how the financial markets traded today. Major stock indices in Asia were mixed as investors assessed newly released economic data. The Japanese benchmark Nikkei 225 shed more than 8%, along with the Shanghai Composite closing flat today. Meanwhile, our Singapore Straits Times flat, as well as Australia's ASX 200. Let's take a look now at futures in Europe. They are set for a mixed open as investors brace for corporate earnings in the region. Companies set to report before the bell include Volvo, Nokia, EasyJet, and German software firm SAP, or SAP. Over on Wall Street, futures slipped after Netflix reported revenue that missed expectations. Traders also watching out for initial jobless claims and existing home sales data. The Dow Jones looks set to break its longest winning streak at 8 sessions in nearly 4 years. Now for more local corporate stories, Double Dragons Hotel 101 has signed master service agreements with 3 Spanish firms, Oriens PSI Consultants and LNL RSM Law. They will be the exclusive advisory service providers for buyers of Hotel 101 Madrid properties. The 3 are top Spanish advisory firms specializing in the nation's so-called Golden Visa program, which offers investor residency in exchange for an investment. Those who purchase 3 hotel units in the Spain projects will see their Golden Visa processing and advisory fee of around 6,000 euros totally waived. Meanwhile, Metro Pacific Investments and DMCI, the companies behind Maynilad, reports the Supreme Court denied the group's petition to stop Maynilad from implementing a combined drainage sewerage system. The High Court affirmed the Court of Appeals decision, which denied a plea, citing a lack of basis. And finally, Philinvest Group issues a proposal to Cebu City's government to increase its water supply by constructing desalination and treatment plants. The Philinvest Group says over 300,000 households in Cebu City will get more water supply should the plan continue. Now, Cebu City Mayor Mike Rama, for his part, supports the initiative.
Now, the Philippine Amusement and Gaming Corporation says first half revenues jumped 36% to hit 36.2 billion pesos. That's just 7% short of its pre-pandemic performance. Its chairman, Alejandro Tenco, remains confident the agency can ride on the play and revenge spending and exceed its pre-pandemic levels by the end of this year. PAGCOR's contribution to nation building also rose 49% year-on-year to 22.62 billion pesos. Of that figure, 16.20 billion pesos went directly to the National Treasury. PAGCOR has come under intense scrutiny after the recent raid on a POGO center in Las Piñas that uncovered a massive human trafficking operation and online scams. PAGCOR was also heavily criticized for its new logo that cost 3 million pesos.
We've already touched on one important accomplishment, which is to build up our pipeline of foreign direct investment potential. That's happening in the approvals that are being made by the Board of Investment, BOI, of which I'm the chair, and it operates under DTI, and also PESA. And the presidential visits, we have more than a dozen, and DTI has always taken the lead in organizing the business activities, including the one-on-one meetings with prospective investors, the roundtable discussions with other investors, and a general investment and business forum, you know, that will include many more participants. We've done that in a number of countries. These are all the sources of investment. We could feel, you know, the growing interest in the Philippines. Some say that we're becoming the favorite in the region.
You're back on the Business Roadshow. That was Trade Secretary Alfredo Pascual, who remains bullish. The Philippines will climb into the top three nations in Asia with the highest foreign direct investments by the end of President Marcos's term. Pascual said the country has already logged 290 investment projects in the first year of the Marcos administration. This, he said, is due to the policy reforms made by the government. The country posted $9.2 billion of FDI in 2022, slightly lower than the record $10.5 billion from 2021. For context, in that same year, Thailand reported $12.3 billion in FDIs, while Vietnam attracted $27 billion. Meanwhile, Pascual also underscored government's plans to increase renewable energy projects in the country. He said this will help avert a power crisis and mitigate the effects of climate change.
For the first quarter, we had request for or applications for approval coming from renewable energy companies, particularly offshore wind, which are which will amount to hundreds of millions of euros from Germany. There are other projects that will follow in the wake of this initial entry, very aggressive plans for increasing the share of renewables in our power generation mix. Right now we're 25%, but mostly geothermal and hydro. And we want the renewable component of our energy mix to get to 35% by 2030 and by 50% by 2050.